On today's episode, we're getting in the first build project of 2015 by stepping out of the shop, coming into my brand new office space, and talking about my design process. It's not really a process. It's just me drawing stuff up.
Welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop. Sponsored by
MicroJig, maker of the Gripper. Work safer. Work smarter.
Also, please consider becoming a patron of Matt's Basement Workshop. Get early access to new shows, bonus content from each episode, and so much more. Visit patreon.com/Matt's Basement Workshop to sign up and start receiving your benefits today.
Hey everybody, welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop. So it's time to get started with our first build project of 2015, and it's going to be a dresser for my daughter, Madison. Now, the first thing I want to do is I want to let you know that this is going to be kind of a bit of a talky episode. I want to share with you how it is that I go about the design process with any project, especially a big one like this. So if what you're really looking for is kind of getting more into the actual construction itself, working with the wood, working with tools, that's going to be coming up soon. But this episode and maybe even the next one are a little bit more kind of like a lecture series. But I promise I won't bore you too much, or hopefully I won't. So anyways, when it comes to the design process, we each have our own unique way, and we're probably more similar than we are different. For me, the main way that I get inspired to build my projects is something along the lines of this.
Hey, I know how you can get some inspiration.
Oh yeah?
Why don't you just go down to Madison's bedroom and look at her floor? It might inspire you to build a dresser.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, so that is a little bit of an exaggeration. When it comes to actually being presented with a project, it is oftentimes a lot nicer, but still you kind of get the basic idea. In other words, a need is identified and we sit down and figure out what it is we're going to do to fulfill that need. In this case, my daughter Madison needs this dresser, and so I am going to build it. And why am I going to build it? Well, it's because we haven't been able to find anything really that fits the area that we're looking for, or has all of the drawers that we're looking for, all of this stuff. So that is the main reason why I'm going to do this. Now, oftentimes at this point, once we've identified the need, we're going to sit down and say, what is it going to look like? I mean, we need to have a starting point for the design. And typically what I would do is oftentimes I would then take a piece of paper and a pencil and start drawing it out. And it could be something as simple as on a cocktail napkin or full-size sheet of paper. And what I like to do at this point is I don't want to get lost in the details. I don't want to sit down and make sure that I have, you know, absolutely straight lines and know right off the top that the height is going to be 58 inches and that it's 49 inches wide and all this stuff. These are things that will come later on. First, I want to create that just overall, what is the look of it? And then once I have that, we can then start filling in this other information and figuring out, all right, based on this location in her room, we know that we're limited by this amount of space and that we need it to have about yay tall. And because she has so many sweaters, some of the drawers need to be, you know, X number of inches deep, all that kind of stuff. That then starts playing into it. Now, if you're the type of person that this stuff still is something that you're uncomfortable with, it's very easy to maybe, rather than starting from scratch, start with an existing project that's out there. And there's nothing wrong with going this route. I know a lot of people are always saying things like, well, you know, you can't steal somebody else's design. You're not stealing the design unless you're taking the same exact project and making it look exactly like it and then turning around and selling it and claiming it's your own. That's a whole other issue, and we're not going to talk about it with this one, but what I do want to mention is sometimes we can take a design and then start to kind of tweak it to fill the need that we have. So for example, when we were trying to figure out the dimensions for this, we already knew equivalent space that we had, and again, how wide it needs to be and how deep, but we also discovered that there was a dresser through, I believe this is IKEA, that was kind of something that we might actually consider. But again, if we could build it the way we wanted, this is what we would build off of. So this is something I frequently will do also. I'll find an existing project and then tweak it to my needs. So now that we have what the thing is going to look like, and we know approximately where it's going to be going, and maybe even some rough dimensions, it's time to really start getting down to figuring out the exact dimensions so I can come up with a materials list and get started. And what I'm going to do now is we're going to move over here to the computer, and I'm going to show you my SketchUp drawing that I have for this. So over here at the computer, I am definitely not one of those people that is extremely proficient in SketchUp here, but I can use it just enough that it really helps me come up with the projects themselves. So after doing all those rough drawings and coming up with my approximate dimensions that I'm going to work with, I then can easily start putting them in place here in SketchUp and drawing out my components. And what I really like about SketchUp is, of course, that I can easily move things around and get a feel for it and draw them and put them in place and say, all right, now how am I going to do this? Where's this going to go? And all of that stuff. So I'm not going to give you a lesson on SketchUp other than just to say it's pretty darn cool to be able to do these things. But I think the big thing here is the fact that it once again helps me to draw something out and be able to present it to whoever it is that's going to be getting it and say, what do you think about this particular piece right here? Is this what you like? What can we tweak about it? And it also, quite honestly, can give me a feel for my joinery. And here, in this case, you can see I've got these dados going in what's going to be the side. So let's talk a little bit more about the actual dimensions themselves, because at this point, I have the finalized dimensions for the project itself. I need to start thinking about the materials. So let's go into discussing the materials. Now, something else that I probably should mention before we go any further is it's important when designing your project to think about the fact that you might have certain limitations. Maybe these are limitations on the materials. Who knows? Maybe for whatever reason in your area, you can only get boards that are so wide or so thick. And I know this is kind of reaching on this one a little bit, but it could actually be an issue. You may end up spending way more money than it turns out it might be worth doing. So that's something to think about. That's kind of a lesson. One, but a more important one, which I think a lot of people don't think about, are the limitations on the tools that you're actually using. So for example, if say with this particular dresser, the deepest drawer that I'm going to make, let's say it was going to be, I don't know, 10, 12 inches deep, because we really want to pack some sweaters in there. And I know for a fact that I want to resaw solid wood material to make up the sides of the drawers and the back and all that good stuff. But the problem is, with my existing bandsaw, I don't have that kind of resaw capacity on it. So I would maybe have to resaw something a little bit narrower, and then I have to glue those up. So these are things that you might want to think about, because perhaps you're not comfortable doing these things. Of course, there are other ways around them, which is always a possibility to discuss later on, maybe borrowing somebody else's or hiring that work out or something. But it's one of those things that when you have the opportunity to draw these things up and play around with the dimensions and all that stuff, you can really kind of get into it and be like, this is going to be the most awesome thing in the world. And then when it comes down to actually doing it, you're like, oh, wait a minute. Oops, I kind of messed up here. I'm not sure how I'm going to compensate for this. But anyways, though, that's definitely one thing to mention. So now that we have everything here and we know our components, we have an idea of the dimensions that we need for it, let's start putting together our materials list. And when we put together a materials list, of course, this particular project is going to be made out of solid wood. There is going to be some plywood in there for those drawer bodies and stuff. But for the solid wood components, I start adding everything up and I start getting my board feet. And it's important that when you start determining your board feet, for myself, I know that there's going to be mess ups here and there. So what I like to do is to add in a little oops factor. Oftentimes, people will say, like, you know, 25% more is definitely a way to go. I have actually found that 25% just takes me almost to exactly what I need. So I may even bump it out to 30% or something. But regardless of what the percentage of extra board feet you add onto it, definitely add on extra board feet, because I can guarantee even when you take the greatest precautions, something is going to end up happening. And on top of it, you may discover that the board that you thought was perfect for this particular component, there may be a defect that was hidden until you start milling it or something. So it's always good to have, say, a little bit extra on hand. Now, one more thing I should mention, and this one has bitten me in the back a few times because I didn't pay close enough attention to it. When you're drawing up everything and you're creating that materials list, it's really important to think about the joinery itself and how they connect in there, because oftentimes, even if it's a joinery technique where maybe it's hidden away, when we're looking at that project as a whole, when everything is in place, we might actually be thinking, oh, well, I'm just going to measure for the portion that I see right here and forget to measure for, say, those tenons that kind of get tucked away inside the body of the sides or something like that. I know this sounds really foolish to be thinking this way, but I've done that before where I have looked at the actual drawing itself, the finished drawing, and completely forget to compensate for the extra material that I would need to allow those joinery pieces to be in there, especially on things like dovetails and stuff. I don't know why, it just happens. So make sure that you pay close attention to this. And again, this is where adding that little extra in there is always a great idea. All right, folks, this is a pretty good place to stop right now. We can definitely keep going on and on about the design process. Each one of us probably has our own little unique way. They might be very similar, but I'm sure each of us does it just a slightly different, and there is nothing wrong with that. Whatever works for you, stick with it. It's just, if you're getting the results you want, I don't see a reason why you need to change. I know a lot of people, the whole drawing it on a napkin and then maybe taking it to sketch up is one step too many. Maybe for others, it's not enough. You might even take it so far as to build full-size mock-ups so you can really tweak the joinery and the sizes and the dimensions and all that stuff. And if that's the way you do it, that's awesome for you. It's not for me, but that doesn't mean that it's not right. In fact, who knows? Maybe I am absolutely missing out on something. But anyways, one thing I do want to mention, and I probably should have talked about it in this episode, but this is going to be the bonus footage for the patrons of Matt's Basement Workshop, and that's going to be talking about non-traditional joinery, where I would end up using it most in my designs and in my projects. And by non-traditional joinery, I'm talking about stuff like pocket holes or maybe even biscuits, stuff like that. There are places for it, and I don't use it in every single project, but once in a while I do, so we'll be talking about that. If you'd like to become a patron of Matt's Basement Workshop, please check out the information over at my website, or you can head over to patreon.com/Matt's Basement Workshop, where you could sign up and become a patron of Matt's Basement Workshop for as little as $2 a month. But regardless, I love hearing from all of you, so if you have a comment, question, or suggestions, you can email me at mattsbasementworkshop@gmail.com. You can leave a comment in the show notes over at my website at mattsbasementworkshop.com, or of course you can leave a comment here at YouTube if that happens to be where you are watching it. So until the next time, I will be talking to all of you soon. Straight grains and sharp blades. Happy designing, everybody.
Thanks for watching. For more information on topics discussed in this episode, visit mattsbasementworkshop.com. Also, please consider becoming a patron of Matt's Basement Workshop. Get early access to new shows, bonus content from each episode, and so much more. Visit patreon.com/Matt's Basement Workshop to sign up and start receiving your benefits today.